Into our lives and the life of the church, Father God, and Lord God, most of all, you want to speak into the life of a broken world. And in our case, our world is Carbis Base and Ives and this whole surrounding area of Cornwall. So, Father God, today, would you speak to us so that we might be a people who are enthused, Lord God, for your kingdom, and a people who are set in our ways and our thinking for this lost world. Father God, we pray that today you will speak to us. Lord God, you love this world. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish. But Father God, there is a real element of that where we have to share the love of God to all people. And that might be through our homes, that might be through our circumstances, our workplaces, that might well be with our neighbours, that might well be online, whoever it is, Father God, you have called us to be a people of promise to this world. So Lord God, help us this morning, give us ears to hear what your Spirit says, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, just give me a wee second till I take a drink. All right, I've got a message, and I've got the beginnings of a brand new series, which actually came out of the blue. I really wanted to preach something on the Old Testament, and I was thinking, God, what do you want to say after the new year? And because I love the Old Testament, and I love it's really, really great to preach from. But this series come up, and I'm just going to do my best with it. Is that okay, church? I think you can only do your best with what God gives you, because with this, I've been at this for 2 weeks. I was going to start this last week, and I put it off because there was just so much information. And can I tell you something? I could spend weeks just on this one message, easily. And the reason why I held off was because there was I read up and I was looking at this and I was off on a tangent that way and this way and the next way and I don't know how many ways there are, but it was really, I just felt God wanted to speak to us, his church, you guys and me. And I believe he has already spoken to me because they asked me a question. And I don't usually say that because it sounds a bit of a silly sort of thing to say when you're preaching stuff, but I really believe that God asked me a question through this. I'm going to ask you the same question. So we're going to look at the seven churches of Revelation. The title I've given this is The Dangers of a Loveless Faith. All right? I actually had a cracking one come down the road, something like How to Stop a Cardiac Arrest. And I thought that's a really good one. And you'll get what I mean in a second. I can honestly say that what I want to come out of this message, there is an application to it, but really what's probably going to come out of this is I'm going to chuck a load of stuff at you, and I'm going to do it as quickly as I can, and my hope and my prayer is that you guys will go away, and it will just explode in your lives, that you can, because I can't cover everything. So if I miss something, go away and read it up yourself. You alright with that? Fantastic. Here we go. Now, as I was preparing this, and I was off on one of my tangents and my thinking, I began to think about the subject of divorce, which is not the cheese of subjects that we can look at. But I looked at some statistics around the area of divorce, and you will probably know some of these, but they reckon that in the UK, that 42% of married couples are expected to get divorced. But since 1964, in actuality, about one-third of marriages actually end up with divorce. I'm not going to give you a load of the statistics, but there's a point to what I'm going to say here. They reckon that a divorce, and I know there's houses involved, but financial cost roughly is about £12,700 per divorce. That's how much it costs for that, you know. And around one third, as I said, the average length of a marriage before divorce is only 12.3 years. 12.3 years. And I thought this was really interesting, this one here, before I sort of launches off into this message. But they reckon that unreasonable behaviour is the most common reason for divorce in the UK. Okay, I'm going to spiritualise it in a second and draw the parallel. But Ellen Boyd says this in March 15, 1993. He said this: why do so many toy makers watch the divorce rate? When it rises, so do toy sales. According to analysers, four parents and eight grandparents tend to compete for the children's affections, so they buy toys. Unreasonable behaviour is cited as the most common reason for divorce. And I want to ask you a question this morning to ponder. And this is not the question I come up with, but the question being, when we see Christians fall out of church and they fall out with other Christians and so forth and it causes a big problem, then I wonder if God cites the reason as unreasonable behaviour on our behalf. You with me, church? I wonder if God sits there and says, you know what? You've walked away from me. That's unreasonable behaviour. See, God will never leave or forsake us, but we can him, can't we? There are many Christians who come to church because of duty. How many of you know that you can be living in the same house with someone but have a loveless relationship? There can be no love in the house. And so what happens is, sometimes as Christians we come to church and our humanity, we bring that stuff into church where we have a loveless relationship with other people because of our insecurities and so on and so on and so on and so forth. This pandemic has caused a sifting in the church. One person told me recently, and I've quoted this, that church attendance is down to 60% in across the UK. My point is this: there are many Christians in churches who get divorced from God. Many Christians, many churches. Matthew 15, before I launch into Revelation, says this: these people honour me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. When I got married to my wife, my marriage illustration for this week, I gave her my heart, my life. Now, we have moments, like all you guys. Now, you guys are perfect, aren't you? Okay? But we have moments like... I'm getting out of disbelief again. Yeah, you're right. Come on, church. We have moments in all of our lives, but you know what? You can live in a house and in a loveless relationship. I give my heart, my life to my wife. Obviously, God first, okay. Let me just say that. In any relationship, you have to continually make it work. I'm just teaching your grandmother to suck eggs with this one, aren't we? Yeah? Divorce from God is costly. It costs you your peace, your relationship. You become estranged from your Christian friends. You lose the emphasis of your ministry if you're there. What happens when we walk away from God? Well, Hebrews chapter 6 says this: for it is impossible in the case of those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, and who have shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the word of God and the powers of this age to come, and then have fallen away, to restore them again to repentance, since they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding him up to contempt. I don't need to say any more about that. But we're going to look at the church of Ephesus. And I have to say, I've just loved looking at this. And the reason why I've loved looking at it is because, as I said a long time ago, when people write a letter in the Bible, often you see the answers, but you don't often see the questions that were asked to give those answers. But when you look at the book of Revelation, and you look at the seven churches, you can see why Jesus has a problem with this church. And it's been good. Anyways, here we go. Revelation chapter 1, we're going to begin there, but we're going to begin at verse 19. If you've got your Bible and you're taking notes. Write therefore what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you have saw in my right hand and the seven gold lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. Now, I could spend a week just on that one, but I won't. I just want to draw your attention to one or two things. Number one, there is a lot of eschatological discourse in this. In the sense of, if we look at this, as soon as you mention Revelation to anyone in the church, it's all about end times. Now, I just want us to hold that thought, okay, because I'm not trying to say that there isn't end times, and of course there is, we see that. But I want to make a point today that they were reading a letter written to those people, the Ephesians, in that time and in that place. And that is so important. Now, I've heard all sorts of theories about this throughout my time, and I'm not going to go down any of these today because it's not worth it. But for example, you know, there's dispensationalism. If you want to go away and look that one up, you're more than welcome to. But I've heard things like, well, these seven churches represent seven times in the first century, or these seven churches represent seven centuries, and I'm not going to go there. What I want to say is this, that, as I said, that John writes this letter from Jesus, and I actually would like to say it's probably kind of a love letter. Because he points out one or two things, or three or four things, and he wants to make the church aware of what's good and what he's sorted. Now, there are times in our lives when we recognise that God wants us to sort something out, don't we? We have the Holy Spirit within us. And he prompts us. So the only one I'm just going to mention out of that whole thing there, obviously the seven churches are the seven lampstands and so forth. And the angel here literally means messenger or one sent. You probably know that one already. And to be fair, every commentary I read doesn't come down on whether it's an elder of the church, whether it's a leader of the church, whether it's an angel, a little angel. It doesn't actually say that. But the fact is, it's a messenger or one sent. And God wants to get their attention. Now, with regards to the seven lampstands, okay, I just want to just point this out to you, because I just came up as I was thinking this, that remember this, that God can speak into the life of you and I in this church anytime he wants. Matthew chapter 5, you are the light of the world. A city or a town on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and gives light to everyone in the house. And there is a clear warning in that. It's important that we remember that. But there's a clear warning that you and I, as we represent we represent Jesus, we are ambassadors. Can I just say that if we just picture ourselves just for a moment as a lampstand, we don't want to be a church which is snuffed out. You with me, Josh? Okay. Martin's with me. Okay, Revelation chapter 2. Here we go. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not. You have found them false, you have persevered and have endured hardships for my name, and have not grown weary. That is an understatement of what I have been studying and reading up. We're going to come to it. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favour. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. And really, the first part of this, I just want to say this. I hope if this really gets your mind going and really gets your spirit moving, that you will see that I really just have to say what I need to say, and you guys go and read it up for yourself. So good. So all the letters follow a similar pattern to the angel. Start my pinky. To the angel. Jesus is depicted in glory. And then he says, I know. But then he says, but I have this against you. And then to the one who is ears, and then he comes up with as an eschatological promise, so something to come. And we see that obviously unfolding throughout the book of Revelation. The church of Ephesus was an incredible church. It was the place to be, apart from Corinth, if you remember our Bible study on Corinth. Okay, it was a place to be in the first century. Tradition has it that John himself had pastored the church here before being exiled to Patmos, where he writes the book of Revelation. It was a key inland trade route. Actually, initially it was on the coast. Bernard and Jennifer will probably tell you this. But later on, because of seismic activity, they moved the whole city 3 miles inland to where we actually see it today. So it was a key inland trade route, and as a result, it welcomed people from all different spheres of life. It was an incredibly cosmopolitan place to live in. Now think London or Edinburgh, where people come from all over the world to settle and move about and then spread out from there. And it would have rivaled some of the great cities in our world, you know, because it held not just one temple, and actually there's more temples, I'll come back to this, but it actually held one key temple, but another one came along as well. So actually, it was very unique within the Roman Empire, and we will explore that a little bit. But think about this, a world-renowned city, Singapore, New York, that kind of thing. So people came from all over the world to wonder at this place. Paul himself stayed in Ephesus preaching the gospel for about 2.5 years because of that very trade route. It was the first of the seven churches in its positioning to the wider world, as it were. Why did he do that? Because if you want to preach the gospel and you want to get it out there, then what you do is you go to a place where there's a lot of people interconnecting, interchanging, and moving about. So therefore that word goes way beyond them in that place. Within Ephesus, the Agora, which was the marketplace, and just inside of the doorway to that, there was an incense burner. Now here we go. If we begin to think about what the Ephesians church, what the church had to deal with, this is where we come into all those different areas. So inside the Agora, the marketplace, there was an incense burner. And what you would do is you would walk through the doorway, you'd pick up a pinch of incense, and you'd drop it into the burner. And what it was a sign of loyalty to the Roman Emperor, Nero, whoever that might well be. Now, if you're a Christian, and your loyalty is to Jesus, and not to a worldly authority, and I'm not saying we don't pray for those in authority, you know where I'm coming from, but we are talking about, you know, humanistic worship here. That's the difference. If you're a Christian, you're going to have a problem with that, aren't you? Not doing this meant that Christians were shut out from the marketplace in the everyday life. If you look at today, the best illustration I could come up with was this. Austria recently has decided to bring in laws about, and this kind of touches base to our point, but Austria today has brought in laws about with regards to COVID, haven't they? If you're unvaccinated, you're not allowed to go to the restaurants and the cinema and this place and that place. You're allowed to go to work, you're allowed to go home, but that's pretty much it. So the point being that you were completely shut out from society. That's not great if you want to spread the gospel and you're potentially going to get into trouble by the authorities. Then it gets on. So we look at the environment. So you're buying groceries, which is a normal fact of life, would have been different. If you want to go to the doctor, okay, or you want to go exercise, or you want to do anything, you're shut out from life. Now, there were 14 different idolatrous temples to pagan gods, okay, in Ephesus. And the most important one was Artemis. Have you guys been there? Temple of Artemis. It was the most important one. Artemis was the god of fertility. I want to tell you all this because there's a reason behind it. As we look at the idolatry in the passage today, as we look at, you know, the serving other gods and so forth, which is all in there. So the reason why I'm giving you this information is to show you what they were up against. Artemis was the god of fertility and life. The temple was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. And many prostitutes operated within the temple itself. That, we're going to come back to that right at the end. But there was also the worship of Emperor Domitian. Now, the Emperor Domitian, you get this, guys, you're with me. The Emperor Domitian, so a bit of a history lesson this one, he was second only in temperament, as I say, okay, or temper, to Nero in the ancient world. So you think Nero, and he's like next step down. Bad news. Nero persecuted the Jews to no end. And you know, if you read your history about that, and that's another story for another time. But Domitian next to Nero was the most brutal persecutor of early Christians. He set himself up as a temple, and his view of himself was to get all the other emperors from the past and their statues and put that, and then put on top of that a plinth with his own statue on top of it. So he was above everybody else who had ever come before. On top of that, he set himself, his temple was in the highest place of Ephesus. Christians would normally fly under the radar, but by the time he came to power, I think it was AD 82, I think it was around about then, he was determined to wipe out Christians. He was determined to get them to worship him in that place. So you can appreciate that Ephesians 6, when it says this, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against every power and principality. You can also appreciate when Paul talks about the armor of God, put on the full armor of God, these guys were up against it, big time. Then there was the Nicolaitans. Nicolaitans. And who were they? They were a cultish group of religious people who absorbed Greek philosophy and its Gnosticism. It taught that the body was insignificant and the only thing that was important was the soul. Now, that sounds good. That almost sounds Christianese, doesn't it? But let me explain. It went to the point where, okay, the soul is great, but what they were saying was you could get drunk. You could do whatever you want to your body. You could eat food sacrificed to idols. You could commit immorality. And so into this incredible arena of faith and culture, John brings a letter within a letter. And that letter was a circular one which around all the seven churches. So bad news is like someone writing a letter to us and then passing that letter on, okay, by the way, you got this wrong, you've messed up here, and we're going to pass it down to the Methodists. Then we're going to pass it on to the Salvation Army. Then we're going to pass it on to the Anglicans. And then that's what it was like. So you kind of, you were in it. Yeah. So, the one thing that we know here is that the seven churches would have known exactly, as I've just described in some format, exactly what Jesus was on about when John wrote this letter. 30 years, the church at Ephesus appeared to be excelling at all levels. They were committed to sound doctrine. They were guarding against false teaching. They sought to do good works in the community around them. They ferociously defended the glory of Christ's name for all other names, above all other names. And they staunchly defended against moral compromise. On many fronts, they appeared to be the perfect church. I want to go there. Yet for all they were doing well, Jesus comes in with a showstopper phrase after saying, I love this about you, that's great, you're doing that well, and he says this, I hold this against you. Now, that is not a phrase any of us want to hear, is it? And I just want to challenge you, has God said that to you recently? I hold this against you. You need to sort this out. Because despite all your good works, if you fall down in one, really, reality says you fall down the lot. Could Jesus say that about us? Notice that it doesn't also say, come back to your first love. It actually says you have forsaken the love you had at first. In other words, they had forgotten what it is to love Jesus and what he loves. Ultimately, Jesus was saying to them that the church for you is like a habit. You've forgotten about me, your first love. You've forgotten what I love. It's become a duty, just something that you and I do. What Jesus really longs for us to do is to love him out of relationship, not out of duty. How many times do we walk through the church doors and say, right, here we are again. The format is we're going to do a bit of worship. We're going to have a bit of fellowship. And we're going to... And we've done that for some part of all of our lives. And then we go to another church and they do it slightly differently. And then we go to another church and they do it slightly differently. And it's like the format. And when do we actually consciously get up in the morning and say, I'm going to praise you, God, when I get to church? Rather than, I wonder what's going to happen. I wonder what songs we're going to sing today. I wonder what you want to say to me. Do you know what I'm saying? When do we come to church expecting God to speak to us? Before we even get there. As I was writing this message, and here's my question. I was really challenged to consider, how much do I really love Jesus? Now, you guys know me well, pretty much. Well, you've known me for a year now. My life consists of family, sleep, work, church. Occasionally, Lucy and I will go out for a meal or something. But primarily, my time is spent on those four things. I go from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next. Sometimes the order changes. But it can seem like duty. I hope and pray that it never does. But what I'm saying is, how often do we consciously stop and say, am I doing this out of duty? Now, of course, we have a church to run, church. We've got people that we need to share the love of Jesus with. But when do we stop and ask the question, are we doing it out of duty and not out of love? Has it become the role of life just to keep on doing what we do because we do it, we've always done it, and so forth? Is that where we're coming from? Have I been doing so Christianity for so long that I got into routine? Am I going through the process? Am I taking the relationship with God for granted? Do I have a plan to go deeper in God and develop that relationship? Jesus calls them to do the things they did at first. They had forgotten. You know, if the church was only, what? I mean, talk about AD, what, 95? Okay, the church started 30, 40 years. And they'd already forgotten what it's all about. And to be fair, compared to today's society, they didn't have much choice to go down to the church down the road. Because there wasn't too many of them about. Okay, you could pick one of the other six. But as you know, they've got problems there as well. You couldn't very well say, well, I didn't really like that denomination. It was Christianity or nothing. I think I'll head off to that church there because they've got a better worship band than us. Oh, do you know what? They pray louder than I, so. Do you know what? They've managed to get that far. Do you get the point, don't you, church? It was all or nothing. Okay. If this passage is a passage centered around what it is to love, then I have a better question. If you love Jesus, then what is it that he loves? The Bible says, if you love me, you will keep my commands. So what we're going to do is, I can run off on a tangent anyway, but I'm going to give you, I think it's five brief things, to look at what Jesus loves. Because if you love him, you will do the rest with all your heart, soul, mind and strength. That's a word for us this year, it's our last year, which we looked at so often. Number one, Jesus loves believers. How often do we see people fall out with other Christians? Well, do you know what? We're just going to let them go. We're just going to, you know, that's up to them. We're never going to speak. Not Jesus loves. Oh, do you know Jesus loves the person sitting beside you? So why don't you turn to them and tell them right now, Jesus loves you. Come on, church. Now, the harder thing is, Okay? Why don't you turn to your neighbour and say, do you know what? In Jesus' name, I love you too. Come on, church. Okay, number three. If you're sitting beside your married spouse, okay, you're married to them, can you turn to someone you're not married to and tell them, because guess what, you've got to live for the guy or the woman you're beside. So come on, let's turn to someone else and say, yes.
Did you say number two?
Number one, this is. Get to number two in a second. Okay. Great stuff, guys. Okay, so John chapter 15, let's root it in scripture as we should do. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So Jesus is passionate about the person beside you, the believer down the road, the person that you might have fallen out with in the past and you need to go and sort something out with. Here I come. Okay. So God loves believers. The believer sitting next to you is loved by God just as much as he loves you. But his love for believers must be reflected in our love in the community, our love when we meet someone other. Now, today, it's probably not culturally good, and it's certainly not health-wise good, but in the day, they would have greeted one another with a holy kiss, wouldn't they have done? Now, obviously, that's kind of a little bit iffy in our culture, but then you get COVID added on top of that. But there's nothing wrong with going and saying hi to someone, your fellow believer, and saying, you know what, great to see you, I just want to tell you in Jesus' name I love you. Can we do that? Okay, 1 Corinthians 14. I reckon that this is one of the hardest passages in the Bible to follow. We all love the lovey-dovey bit, but here we go. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not dishonored. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Okay, love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. And as I said before in a Bible study last year, the word for love is agape. It's not eros, it's not sexual love, which we sometimes get read out of weddings. It's talking about Christian brotherly love. So agape, love, okay, love. Love is patient. Be patient with your brother or sister. Love is kind. Be kind to them. It does not envy. It does not brag about stuff. And so forth. Let me suggest to you, it is one of the hardest passages that we could ever follow in the Bible. Let's not kid ourselves on, church. And if it isn't, then why do so many churches fall out and people fall out?
Why do so many churches and people fall out? Bring that down a notch.
Number two,
Margaret.
He loves his church. He loves believers, but he loves his church. Ephesians 5, husbands, love your wives, that's a good one, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. The Bible also says in Matthew chapter 12, every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and no city or house divided against itself will stand. So Christ loved the church, loved you and I, loved what he's building here so much that he gave himself up for us.
Am I preaching too much today?
No, it's good stuff.
Okay, but every kingdom, when we allow the enemy into the church, when we allow the enemy into what God is doing, then he can divide the church in a way that can often fall apart. And I'll give you an illustration in a second. But whilst the world looks on, John chapter 3, 13 says this, but by this everyone will know that you're my disciples if you love one another. The week before our wedding, the week before our, anyway, moving on.
Come out in a cold sweat now.
Right.
The week before our wedding, there was a church split in our hometown.
Two different factions. I had to go to the pastor and say, Half the church have left, and they were in my worship band for the week after. What are we going to do about that? So much so, it reached the local newspaper, which has a circulation, just a circulation, not a complete entirety, of 60,000 copies. And that's just the household circulation, not the people who read it within it. So you're talking 150,000 maybe? Reached the local newspaper. I come up with three things I just felt was right, just right. I mean, I could pick 100 things here. There are three things that we need to consciously take care of that I felt relevant. Number one, the area of unity. The area of unity in the church is paramount. Even in disagreement, we find a way through. Number two, the area of forgiveness. You go and ponder these for yourself. The area of forgiveness / unforgiveness. It's a commandment to forgive your brother or sister in Christ. Number three, the area of consideration and not compromise. Hear that correctly. The area of consideration and not compromise. Let me explain. It's really important that we consider one another, but we don't compromise the Word of God. You with me? Okay? I say this because compromise brings division. Compromise brings division. But consideration for others bears in mind love for one another. Okay? Let's nail it to the Bible. The Bible says this: be careful not to become a stumbling block. So when Paul talks about that stuff, okay, he's talking about in the sense of food sacrifice to idols. He's saying, consider what's going on, but don't become a stumbling block to the people. Now we can fit that into any aspect of our lives, can't we? You know, I'm not going to do this because, you know what, I am a staunch Christian. I've been doing this for 40 years and, you know what, you're not going to move me. And we forget about the person who's just become a Christian and they're in a moment of immorality and they mess up and, well, you need to get yourself sorted out right now because you're going to go to the pit of hell again. And you know what? We never consider where people are coming from. Are you with me, Josh?
Everyone say, this is good stuff. It's my honour.
Come on, church. We want to be a church who are in love with what Jesus loves. Yes, we don't compromise, but we consider where people are at in their lives. And the Bible talks about bearing with one another in love, doesn't it? So we bear with one another as we encourage them into a place. Now, sometimes you have to bring a word which is a little bit more directive, but that's why we speak the truth in love. I know someone, not me personally, but I know someone who got a phone call one night. I just want to speak the truth in love. Yeah, right? First of all, I don't really know you. Second of all, you've got no relationship with me. Third of all, no way was that love. That just did not happen. Long time ago. I think it's the only time I've ever... I mean, I was with the person when
doesn't
it happened.
It say, love one another as I love myself?
Hey.
Go for it, Marley.
Right, so we must consider. Number three. He loves the unsaved. Jesus assures us in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And then there's Romans 5:8. Let's complement it by saying God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So, as we love Jesus, we have come to love sinners. There's no love in judgment, is there? Often as Christians, we can be too ready to bring judgment instead of mercy. Judgment instead of grace. Judgment instead of love. I wonder where our thinking takes us when we look at the world. Don't know any better. Spiritually. The world doesn't know any better. They might think they've had a spiritual experience on this, that, the next thing in Buddha and all this religion and stuff. are not spiritually alive in Christ. So how can they know any better? How can they? Because they've never been made alive in Christ in the first place. Okay, moving on. Number four, he loves service. Romans 12, love must be sincere, detest what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Outdo yourselves in honouring one another. Outdo yourselves by honouring one another. Do not let your zeal subside. That's what happened with the Ephesian church. Keep your spiritual fervour, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, persistent in prayer. And here we go. Share with the saints who are in need. Practice hospitality. Serve one another in love. Service for one another is paramount in God's kingdom. Service is God's demonstration on relationship. Service is God's demonstration on relationship. Moody's anecdote said this: show me a church where there is love, and I will show you a church that is a power in the community. Okay? Let me tell you why service is important. You see, the world can give all sorts to good causes, and it can make them feel good. But Christian service keeps pride from our doorstep. Christian service. I reckon that this is a huge part of what they'd forgotten about. We should never serve people out of duty, so to speak. We should serve people out of love for Jesus. Jesus said, do the things you did at first. Was it helping the poor? Was it going the extra mile? Was it practicing hospitality? Was it encouraging other people? Was it giving, was your God's given call to service? Was it, you know, what was it? What did you do at first when you became a Christian out of your love for Christ? And are you still doing it? You have a God-given gift to radically change mankind with. Number five, finally. He loves his enemies. Luke 6. But to you who are listening, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If someone else slaps you on one cheek, turn to them also, the other also. If someone takes your coat, do not withhold your shirt from them. Give to everyone who asks you, and to anyone who takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. We're going to close. I don't need to elaborate on that, dear church. We're going to close. We're going to conclude. Where did we begin? Divorce is costly. Divorce is costly. What is God saying to the Ephesian church here? And to us also. Three things. We're going to come to these. What is the challenge that we can take away from this today? Number one. John, writing for Jesus on his behalf, remember. Remember what happened. Remember where you came from. Remember what you did at first. This is how we apply it. Number two, if you've forgotten, if you're doing it out of wrong motives, repent. Number three, repeat what you should be doing in the first place. We're going to finish off with the most amazing, and it's an illustration, but it's rooted there in history. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, this is an eschatological moment. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Outside of the temple of Artemis, the god of fertility and life, bear that in mind, women would come along, people would come along, but women would come along and would touch the tree in the hope of getting pregnant. A tree stood outside there in the outer courtyard where anyone could get to. It was a gigantic tree which represented life. It was known as the tree of life. People who wanted health and life abundance would come to the tree, as I said, they would touch it, and it was the source of hope and fullness of life. Jesus, as I said, this is a word for the church of the day. But here's where it comes to us, and we can see this overflowing into the book of Revelation here. Jesus comes along and says, to those who are victorious, I will give the tree of life. You see, he uses a picture of what's there in their situation, and he says, hey, forget about that thing. I've got a better thing for you. I've got the tree of life. Paradise. And that's not even getting into the health and wealth of the emperors and their vast, amazing gardens. Not like the Lost Garden of Heligan. These things are amazing. But church, to he or she who overcomes, I will give the tree of life, the real tree of life. Amen? I hope and I pray that this has encouraged you guys to go away and read the book of Ephesians, to consider the words, look more into what I couldn't say today. There's so much there. And look at the greatness of God. But more than anything, that we take away those things, that we look at our lives, what have we forgotten? Have we forgotten our first love? Have we forgotten what he loves? And are we doing the things that we need to be doing in our lives, in our day-to-day living? Amen? You call my name, and I raise